Serious, doctors of Reddit, what is the rarest disease that you've encountered in your career? Mucosa Saber. It's a rare form of scleroderma that makes your skin look like you've been cut by a knife down the center of your face. This poor lady's mandible actually split in half. The rarest I've encountered is kid syndrome. Keratitis ichthyosis deafness. A 5-year-old, very sweet, blind girl who literally had rough, thick, opaque skin on the surface of her eyes. Gorham's disease, aka vanishing skull syndrome. A softball size area of my patient's skull disappeared and left behind a soft spot. She ended up with a plastic plate to protect her brain. Crazy disease. My best friend in high school had this. Part of how I got interested in medicine. Pseudocyesis or hysterical pregnancy. In a woman who was an inmate in the psych wing of a prison I rotated through. She thought she was pregnant with Jesus's triplets and had grown a massive pregnant looking belly, was producing milk, etc. I'm a veterinarian and dogs get a version of this. They get enlarged abdomen, milk, and will sometimes mother, carry around and cuddle with puppy like things like toys or rolled up socks. Harlequin ichthyosis. In med school there was a baby born with this. Basically their skin scales up and peels, removing that very important barrier so kids born with this don't live long. She was just a couple months old and had not yet left the hospital since birth. I have a co-worker with ichthyosis. She has no fingerprints and her skin is scaly. She's also completely bald and very very pale. Most people don't know because she wears makeup, wig and gloves. But I taught a fingerprint class one time and she mentioned it and we did a little print thing with her and it was cool. Febrile dysplasia ossificans progressiva, FOP, a disease that calcifies soft tissue and turns it into bone. When I was a medical student, our group's cadaver had this disease. During dissections we sometimes would get poked by spiky pieces of bone in random areas of her body. Also had a spine that resembled a small turtle shell. I scrolled the thread looking for this as my sister has FOP. She's now 36 and a lot more is known about the disease than when she was a child. Lack of information in her youth led to several misdiagnoses and attempts to treat or operate actually cause D. flare-ups which can quicken spread. We had a patient once, a young girl, who was so sick that it broke our data analysis pipeline. When the code ingested a genome sequencing sample, it attempted to detect the chromosomal sex of the patient. It was using two metrics. The sample was considered female if it, 1, lacked Y chromosome, and, 2, was heterozygous on X chromosome, implying there were two copies of it. Otherwise the sample was considered male. This one sample registered as female on metric 1, no Y chromosome, but male on metric 2. Very little heterozygosity on X chromosome, which was not anticipated and resulted in our pipeline crashing. Upon investigation, it turned out that the parents of that poor girl were brother and sister to each other. As a result, she had very little genetic variation throughout her genome, not just X chromosome, and was consequently very sick, with a plethora of diseases typical for consanguineous births. Brazilian doc here. I live in a really poor part of an already poor country. When I was in my pediatric internship there was this baby with hepatomegaly. Big liver. In my region. The first thing that you have to think about in this case is a disease called Kahlil-Azar, also known as black fever or visceral leishmaniosis. It is an endemic disease which there is a parasite transmitted by a mosquito that can infect people with compromised immune system, like people living with HIV, and kids. This parasite infects the bone marrow and simulates clinical signs of acute leukemia, like chronic fever, spontaneous bruises and bleeding. The patient developed anemia, leukopenia, low white blood cells, and low platelets. To compensate, some organs like liver and spleen take care of the bone marrow function to create new blood cells, and thus, get bigger. This disease is really common in my region, but really rare in other parts, especially non-tropical countries like the US. Anyway, as I was saying, this baby girl, about 1 year old, was admitted to investigate a hepatomegaly, but the catch was that she kept having those episodes of hypoactivity and sleepiness, and sometimes even faintings that would then get better after she was being breastfed. We then checked and saw that she was having lots of hypoglycemia episodes. Her lab was normal, and she had no other clinical signs that would remind of Kayla Azar. Besides the hepatomegaly, the patient had HERS disease, a genetic disorder that makes you produce less glycogen due to an enzyme defect. Never hear of it before meeting this patient, and I think I'll never will meet other one. Interestingly enough, in this same time, I had a patient that was admitted with leukopenia, anemia and low platelets that was also hospitalized to rule out Kayla Azar. But he actually had Fanconi anemia, an also really rare genetic disease. In this one, the bone marrow slowly stops producing blood cells. Besides this, the patient also has kidney, facial, bones malformation and overall physical underdevelopment. Fetus in fetu, 10-year-old boy pregnant with his parasitic twin, PT. Maybe not the rarest, but saw a 4-5-year-old patient with Lesch-Nyhan syndrome on my PEDS rotation in med school. It's an X-linked recessive disease that a quick Google search tells me affects about 1 in every 400,000 individuals. It's due to a mutation in an enzyme involved with DNA recycling. The thing all med students remember about it is for whatever reason these patients have a tendency to self-mutilate. My specific patient had to have a procedure to have all his teeth removed because he would terribly bite his arms unless he was physically restrained. I believe he had an older brother that went through the same ordeal. So sad, but definitely one of the more memorable cases from med school. I just read a journalist's essay about this syndrome. Terrifying stuff. Just knowing that a human body and brain can be so badly affected by a simple mutation. I thought it was much rarer than you've said, and learning the actual rarity is kinda throwing me for a loop. Walking corpse syndrome, Cotard delusion. 17 years in mental health and I've seen it once. The belief that some or all of you is dead. The guy was so certain he was dead he believed he was a zombie. Eye doctor here. Patient had bilateral acanthoma bacheritis. Estimated that 0.0004% of contact lens wearers will be diagnosed with this condition in one eye. My patient had it in both. Acanthoma bacheritis is a rare parasitic infection of your cornea. Malignant hypothermia in my 11-year-old patient. I was only in my second year of anesthesiology residency and I thought she was going to die. I had a salty old anesthesiologist as my attending and she calmly led the whole team through the treatment. My patient did great and her labs were all normal when I took her to the PEDS IQ. I couldn't sleep for 2 nights and still haven't gotten over it. On my OB rotation during a residency, I helped deliver a baby who had spots all over. Further blood testing revealed the baby had developed leukemia while in the mother. Didn't know that was really possible prior to that day. Incredibly rare. I'm a pediatrician. I've seen 2 cases during my formation. It's pretty rare. My colleagues had a patient with catecholamine-induced ventricular tachycardia. AKA every time this 13-year-old exercised vigorously or even got too scared, the adrenaline would induce a deadly arrhythmia that needs to be shocked before long in order for him to survive. Seriously. Objective tinnitus. I could lean close to the patient's ear and hear a ringing noise coming out. Central deafness. Patient had an anoxic brain injury and was essentially deaf even though there was nothing wrong with his ears. Dermatologist here. Some fun ones. Chromhidrosis, where sweat comes out in different colors. My patient's was blue. Argyria, a permanent discoloration from silver overdose. Aquagenic urticaria, an allergy to contact with water. When I was in nursing school I took care of a woman with fibrodysplasia ossificans progressiva. Basically your muscles slowly calcify to bone, and every injury, even small ones, speed up the process. She was pretty much wheelchair bound and needed 24-hour care. Neurologist here. We see a lot of weird stuff. Autoimmune encephalitis, brain on fire, late onset familial neuromuscular diseases, rare presentations of cancer, or paraneoplastic disorders. But one rare one sticks out for me. We had a patient who had come in with confusion and aphasia, trouble speaking and understanding. We got more of a workup and saw small strokes all over, but in peculiar distributions, and not ones that would explain his findings. Along with it, we saw microbleeds all over superficial parts of his brain. Turns out he has what's called cerebral amyloid angiopathy related inflammation. It's an extremely rare inflammatory subtype of a stroke disorder that we still aren't totally sure what it is. It has similar amyloid deposition you see in Alzheimer's, deposited around vessels, which makes them weak and prone to stroke and bleeding. It causes rapidly progressive dementia. I presented the case to our department, a large academic center, and most had never heard or seen it in their career. A couple of the stroke doctors were the only ones who knew about it, and they'd never seen it. Really interesting case. There's a hereditary form of this disease where I live, Iceland, associated with cystatin C amyloid. Have never seen a case myself though. Most cases have been mapped so far due to genetic screening of families of affected individuals. Patient admitted for something unrelated starts deteriorating for no discernible reason. Has some mild generalized abdominal pain, but other than that no specific symptoms. However, he keeps worsening to the point where he's barely hemodynamically stable. On the abdominal contrast CT, there's fluid everywhere, organs pushed against the abdominal wall, just one enormous gray puddle from the top of his pelvis to his diaphragm. And then, at some point, there's a scribble of white pretty much smack dab in the middle of it all. In this context, signifying active bleeding, it was shaped like the world's smallest firework pop, and it was nowhere close any major vessel. Everyone was dumbfounded for a hot minute. It turned out to be a spontaneous, atraumatic rupture of the cystic artery. No surgeon in the building had ever seen one. Dude underwent embolization and made it out completely unscathed. Persistent genital arousal disorder. Having multiple orgasms a day, at any time, without any stimulation, becomes quite bothersome and uncomfortable, limits your daily activities and sleep is interrupted. Over time patients can become very hopeless. It is remarkable the dissonance between the name and the obvious joke, and the tremendous suffering these patients endure. I remember hearing about a few women with this on some primetime show like 60 Minutes or Dateline or something like that. I was a teenager, so of course I thought it was hilarious for about 30 seconds until they started talking about how horrible it was and that it basically ruined their work lives, relationships, and everything else. It was pretty eye-opening. Rarest disease that I've seen in my career thus far would have to be leprosy. It's something that one hears about in antiquity and something I read about in books, but I never expected to actually encounter it in my career. As a Brazilian doctor, unfortunately, I've lost track of how many patients with leprosy I've seen. It is very interesting to me that this disease is listed here as rare. Geneticist here. I work in a pretty big hospital and we get hard to solve cases from all over the world. Some of the cases are so unique, there is literally no name yet the genetic disorder. So those would be the rarest. But for the sake of this thread, I will discuss something that is not the rarest, but is pretty rare, and one of the most interesting. Prader-Willi or Angelman syndrome. These are two extremely different disorders that are both caused by the same exact genetic mutation. The only difference is if the mutation occurred on the paternal chromosome or the maternal chromosome. If it occurred on the maternal chromosome, you get Angelman syndrome, which typically results in the child being overly happy, laughing all the time with light eyes and hair color, but also severe intellectual and physical disabilities. If the mutation occurred on the paternal chromosome, you get Prader-Willi syndrome, which results in the child having excessive hunger and can literally eat him herself to death, but with only mild cognitive disability. These kids may go a very long time not getting diagnosed and will become quite obese. Bonus disorder if you're still here. Williams syndrome. With this one, the affected individual has an extremely charismatic, outgoing and fun cocktail party personality. They are cognitively impaired in most aspects except for speech and have very unique facial features that are described as elf-like. Genetic counselor here. I'm thrilled to see a geneticist chiming in. It's like this question was tailor-made for the weird stuff in genetics. It's hard to talk about the rare disorders you diagnose when they literally don't have names. LOL. Just offhand, I'd have to say a case of mitochondrial DNA depletion syndrome. Less than 100 cases reported. Anti-NMDA receptor encephalitis, 1 in 1.5 million. Psychotic symptoms, auditory or visual hallucinations, paranoia, Delusions. Due to an autoimmune disorder where your body produces antibodies against NMDA receptors in your brain. We've seen two this past year at our hospital. The real incidence of this could be higher than 1 in 1.5 meters but might not be tested for often enough. Once someone gets labeled a psych patient, consideration of medical etiologies often goes out the window. Alpha Gal. Tick-borne disease that makes you allergic to red meat. Spongiform encephalopathy. Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease. Lone Star Ticks transmitis, which always seemed ironic to me that a Texas-themed parasite would stop you from eating red meat. I had a gentleman who came into the emergency room with extreme fatigue and was found to have very little blood in his body. I asked him what his medical conditions were, and he told me he had polycythemia vera, which is a condition where the body makes too much blood, the opposite. He told me he had been diagnosed years ago but had never needed treatment. At first I thought he was mistaken about his diagnosis, and then I was worried that his bone marrow might have gone into overdrive and eventually burned out. Eventually, we discovered that he did have polycythemia vera, but had been slowly bleeding from an obscure GI bleed, a tiny blood vessel in his small intestine that would come in and out and bleed small amounts into his stool. In essence, his body was self-treating having too much blood by doing its own bloodletting. For years. 1 week he bled a bit too much and got out of whack and ended up in the hospital, which is where I met him. Crazy case. My aunt had this. Sadly, she eventually died of leukemia caused by the treatment for it. More unusually, her husband, brother-in-law and father-in-law all died from leukemia too. I presume a genetic link. Psychiatrist here. Antimedar encephalitis, as seen on the movie Brain on Fire. About 2 cases per million per year. I've actually seen 2 cases 12 months apart. Oh snap, I just had a patient with that. His symptoms were absolutely wild. Then he recovered a bit and threw his headboard at me. I'm glad it's rare, as our neurologist looked at me like I was an idiot when I asked him what it was. OBGYN here. Hum probably conjoined twins. Thoracophagus. And a couple of cases of complete androgen insensitivity syndrome. I'm a PAC, not MD do. I work in psychiatry. Had a patient who came to me with worsened depression, anxiety, insomnia starting 4 months previous, in part related to recent increase in environmental stressors. Started them on an antidepressant. They responded well, even started eating healthier, exercising on a regular basis, stopped smoking. They no-show a follow-up. We get an automatic refill request from the pharmacy a few weeks later. Call and get them rescheduled. My patient makes it to that appointment. Sits down and says, I have to be honest. I don't remember you, or why I was coming here. I can't remember the last 6 months. They ended up in the acutely ill. Fever, confusion, pain. Later they were diagnosed with aseptic meningitis which had injured the brain, resulting in an amnesiac episode. This patient had seen several specialists, including neurology, infectious disease, immunology, and most had come to the conclusion the antidepressant had been the trigger for the meningitis. At the time there were 2 documented cases of a similar nature. The patient ended up becoming a case study. Upside, they were no longer depressed or anxious. Downside, they were back to smoking and having a less healthy lifestyle. Rarity varies a lot by discipline. I'm in general surgery, so I see things like fernies and neck fasc pretty regularly, but have never treated an ear infection in my whole career. That said, strangest presentation for me so far was a gentleman who had had an anti-reflux procedure on his stomach and esophagus. Nissen fund duplication with a hiatal hernia repair, then had a recurrence and got a ray, do which required a procedure to lengthen part of his stomach, colis gastroplasty. After that procedure, you have a staple line in your stomach. His hiatal hernia recurred again, bringing his stomach back into his chest and he formed a connection between his stomach and the sac surrounding his heart. He presented to the emergency department dying because the gas and stomach contents could get into his pericardium. But not out, and his heart couldn't expand adequately to pump. Mad props to the ED doc who figured it out and saved his life before shipping him to me. OB nurse. We had a patient back when I first started who had 2 separate uteruses and cervixes and somehow, with the help of IVF, managed to get pregnant with 1 baby in each. The other case was a patient who was in delivering her 4th set of twins. She had had 4 pregnancies and was pregnant with twins each time. No IVF with this one. Her oldest set were 4 years old. Methemoglobinemia. Proteus syndrome. Child syndrome. Also once sewed up a wound from woolly mammoth. Bite. Palia grad student tripped and fell into a bone reconstruction table. Needed stitches. I diagnosed a patient with cancer of the parotid gland. It has an incidence of less than 1%. It went something like this. He came to me because he was having right jaw pain. I assessed him and nothing was really out of the ordinary. I thought he was having some TMJ because he had been dealing with some stress and he did have pain at the TM joint. A week later he came back with a Bell's palsy, which is a temporary paralysis of one side of the face. This can be caused by inflammation or a viral infection. So I asked the appropriate questions and he had some upper respiratory symptoms the week before. But something was off. So I palpated his jaw again and moved more medially towards his cheek. And he said it was painful midway on his cheek, where his parotid gland was. There was something there. Not a discernible mass, but something was off. That's when I ordered a CT scan. And it was confirmed. I got him to a head neck specialist along with getting him to a cancer specialist. He's currently 2 years out and although he's missing some of his face due to surgery, he's doing surprisingly well. And his spirits are great. My cousin had to have part of her jawbone removed and they never figured out what the mass was, but it's exactly in the same area. This was about 10 years ago and she's recovered well and can eat normally and everything, but her face has permanent asymmetry. If you are new to the channel, you can subscribe. I publish new videos every day. Until then, check another video. Bye for now.